start today's program with a quote from Dr. King. On June 2nd, 1959, King delivered the commencement address at Morehouse College. During that commencement speech, he said, "We must be concerned about every human being." My name is Steve Weiner from Temple Beth Emunah, and it's my honor to be standing here beside Sharon Molden from Messiah Baptist Church. Like I said last year, Messiah is so fortunate to have such a jewel in Sharon. The way that our two churches work together is what Dr. King saw the night before he died when he looked over the mountaintop. In order to get us in the spirit of the day, we would like to welcome Pastor John Page from Mount Moriah Baptist Church to give our opening prayer, immediately followed by the Messiah Baptist Jazz Ensemble under the direction of Gary Lyon.
Good afternoon. It's so good to be here today. Such a melting pot of persons and religious beliefs and faith. I don't know what your faith may be and traditions, but one thing I think we could all agree upon is that we pray and we serve a higher power who is instrumental in helping us to become agents of change and transforming us through His power. And so I would invite you to stand, and whatever your faith tradition might be, as we go to Him who was able to do all things exceedingly and abundantly well. Let us pray. O wise and eternal God, we thank you for this precious opportunity and precious privilege to be able to gather in this space and in this place. For Father, we understand that there was a time where we may not see this gathering even take place. And so, Father, the fact that we're able to come here, men, women, from different backgrounds, different traditions, and stand here together indicates that you are doing a wonderful work within humanity. But God, we also understand that there is much work that needs to be done. And so, Father, we thank you that you are raising up men and women who can function and act as agents of transformation. But Father, that is what you did with Dr. King as you inspired him to take the mantle up and lead the charge in making this world a better place for each and every human who will reside on this earth. Father, we pray that that spirit will continue even in us. That, Father, we would not look at each other's backgrounds or race or ethnicity as a barrier for us to engage with them. But, Father, that we would embrace one another and walk together lockstep as we seek to improve our nation, our communities, and our family. And so we invoke your presence right now. We ask that you would have your way with this service. Father, as we give honor and we remember the legacy of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, continue to help us to be agents of transformation. Transform us so that we may transform our communities through the power of love. That even though our nation might be in certain turmoil over certain disparities, Father, we know that you are able to heal and you're able to use us to be agents of that healing. And so, Father, that's our prayer today, that you would have your way, that you'll continue to inspire and to reach, that you'll continue to break down barriers that will keep us segregated and continue to unite us as one humanity. It is with this prayer, this thought in mind, that we ask and we seek your guidance. And the people of God said, amen.
Amen. Thank you.
second time to Tuskegee Airmen. The women at Temple Beth Emunah was filled with excitement. In a couple days, a new president was about to be sworn in. Many of you were in Washington for that day. Now, we have never been political at this event, but the excitement was overwhelming. Sharon and I thought that even though we were a lot nervous about what lies ahead, we feel people of faith can work to lead to a fair outcome. Dr. King would never stop working in the face of what seems impossible odds. Sharon and I would like to read this prayer that is read at Saturdays at our Shabbat Sabbath service. Our God and God of our ancestors, we ask your blessings for our country, for its government, for its leaders and advisors, and for all who's exercised just and rightful authority. Teach them insights of your Torah, that they may administer all affairs of state fairly, that peace and security, happiness and prosperity, justice and freedom may forever abide in our midst.
Creator of all flesh, bless all the inhabitants of our country with your spirit. May citizens of all races and creeds forge a common bond in true harmony to banish all hatred and bigotry and to safeguard the ideals and free institutions which are the pride and glory of our country.
May this land under your providence
be an influence for good throughout the world, uniting all people in peace and freedom, and helping them to fulfill the vision of your prophet. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they experience war anymore. And let us all say, Amen. It has been my honor to serve as the fake co-chair of this event. Steve Weiner has done almost all of the work, and all I had to do was just unlock the doors to the church. But it is in this spirit that we come together, not as separate institutions or organization, but as one people. And we proudly proclaim that today, we are the recipients of the work of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Amen. It has been our pleasure at Messiah Baptist Church to be co-partners with the Brotherhood of Temple Beth Emunah, and I think that's the correct, of Temple Beth Emunah, and we have learned so much. We've got a new way of making tuna and egg salad, and we know what it means to have a cooperative spirit, willing minds, and able bodies. So this afternoon, we want you to know that you are fully awake to the dream that needs to be worked on, that together as a people, not as separate groups, not as units, but as a group of people willing to aim toward the same goal, that we will put our shoulders and our hands to the plow, and we won't turn back until that dream has been fully fulfilled. So you can't do the work while you sleep. So wake up from the dream. Put into action those things that we've dreamed about, and let's get to the work of God's people.
Sharon and I would like to welcome Chief James D.G. We're just welcoming you right now to our program. We look forward to hearing from you later. Last summer, three members of Temple Beth Emunah passed away. All three were instrumental in the birth of this program. I would like to dedicate this year's program to Leslie Cohen, Billy Krakoff, and Mel Angela. Selma is here today. Thank you, Selma, for coming. And just want you to know, this banner in front of me, Mel Angela designed the year of the creation of BIC for the first BIC convention. And we've used it at our program every year since. So may their memory be with us forever. In 1963, in a writing called Strength to Love, Dr. King wrote, "Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate can not drive out hate. Only love can do that. Hate multiplies hate. Violence multiplies violence. And toughness multiplies toughness in a descending spiral of destruction. The chain reaction of evil, hate, begetting hate, wars producing more wars must be broken, or we shall be plunged in the dark abysses of annihilation." 21 years ago today, with these thoughts in mind, Rabbi Werb started the process of having the light continually shine on here in Brockton. He lit the light that took many of us out of darkness. In order to continue to keep the light shining, I would like to introduce to you Rabbi Andrea Giles and ask her to light this candle, with the candle that's right here, to show our commitment to continuing to keep us out of darkness. Rabbi Giles will then speak.
It's hard to light without a flame.
Oh, it's right here, huh? I'm sorry.
First of all, I'd like to thank Steve and Sharon for all their dedication and commitment to putting together this program. I know how hard it is to be able to line up all the different pieces of a program, and they do it in such a way that comes across as being seamless and effortless. But I do know how much effort really does go into it, so thank you. It is fitting that the day upon which we honor and remember Martin Luther King Jr. occurs in the week within which the Jewish community begins the reading of the book of Exodus. In so many of his speeches, King referenced the Israelite struggle to become free. Moses' anguished and powerful cry of "Let my people go," and the actual Exodus from Egypt as a parallel narrative the experience of African Americans. Like Moses, Martin Luther King Jr. was not able to see the promised land of freedom. And while there have been great strides toward reaching that promised land, we are still in the midst of the wilderness. And as with Moses, who had to constantly reaffirm the positive aspects of freedom when the people felt vulnerable or afraid, we too have to stand up to the forces in our society today who feel threatened by change or by the shifting demographic identity of the United States of America. As people of faith, we intrinsically understand that regardless of color, socioeconomic status, gender, sexual orientation, or religious identification, we are all God's people, made in God's image. And as such, we are all equal before God and before each other. All of our voices need to be heard and respected. We all have the right to be treated as full human beings. We all have the right to feel safe and protected. And when we feel that those rights are being threatened, curtailed, or not respected for any subgroup within the American society, then we all have the obligation and responsibility to stand up and take a stand. We need to stand with the vulnerable, with the oppressed, with the downtrodden, in order to assure that all have access to justice, be it social justice, economic justice, or legislative justice. As Martin Luther King Jr. himself said in his letter from the Birmingham jail, quote, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." Right. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of our destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. At the same time, as people of faith, we also understand that violence is not the means to an end that we would want. In order to heal divisions and seal rifts, we need to reach across to the other by not viewing him or her as other, but rather as us, and find the divine in each of us, be they Republican or Democrat, white or black, police or citizen. And in the same way that King looked to the scriptures for guidance and inspiration, we too can look to his own words as a guiding principle on which to find the path to continue his march to freedom and equality. As part of his speech upon accepting the Nobel Peace Prize, King spoke to the need for nonviolence. I quote, "Nonviolence has also meant that my people in the agonizing struggles of recent years have taken suffering upon themselves instead of inflicting it on others. It has meant, as I said, that we are no longer afraid or cowed. But in some substantial degree, it has meant that we do not want to instill fear in others or into the society of which we are a part. The movement does not seek to liberate Negroes at the expense of the humiliation and enslavement of whites. It seeks no victory over anyone. It seeks to liberate American society and to share in the self-liberation of all the people. Violence as a way of achieving racial justice is both impractical and immoral. I am not unmindful of the fact that violence often brings about momentary results. Nations have frequently won their independence in battle. But in spite of temporary victories, violence never brings permanent peace. It solves no social problem. It merely creates new and more complicated ones. Violence is impractical because it is a descending spiral ending in destruction for all. It is immoral because it seeks to humiliate the opponent rather than win his understanding. It seeks to annihilate rather than convert. Violence is immoral because it thrives on hatred rather than love. It destroys community and makes brotherhood impossible. It leaves society in monologue rather than dialogue. Violence ends up defeating itself. It creates bitterness in the survivors and brutality in the destroyers." End quote. Unfortunately, we have been witnesses to the truth of his words. On this day of commemoration and remembrance, may we all reaffirm our commitment to the ideals and visions of Martin Luther King Jr. May we reach across the divide and embrace each other. May we continue the work that he began, so that one day in the not too distant future, we all can truly rise up and say, as a nation united, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last. Thank you.
Normally at this time I usually read a letter entitled "Greetings from Sunny Florida." Due to family health problems, Rabbi Werb has not gone to Florida this year. He asked me to send his best regards to all of you and that he wishes he could be here with you today in thanking us for keeping Dr. King's dream alive. Messiah Baptist has continually welcomed us with open arms and has helped to keep this light on. It is my honor to now welcome the pastor, Reverend Michael Walker.
We're the children of Nimrod. We shall not live by Ham alone. We're Nimrod's children. And we gladly and happily embrace the legacy of Nimrod and of Vashti. And in the spirit of Nimrod, in the spirit of Vashti, we celebrate this day. We recognize at the same time, as the rabbi just said, we're not out of the wilderness yet. We're not out of the wilderness. When we witness a president, or president-elect, the first meeting in the black community happens to be with a rapper, a comedian, and a football player. That says we're not out of the wilderness yet, because you still think we can carry the ball, but we can't carry the country. And there's something wrong. That's Ham theology. And we shall not live by Ham alone. We're Nimrod's children. We're Vashti's children. And in the spirit of Martin Luther King Jr., and we agree fully, as King said, he can see a person that in all honesty is 80% horrible, 80% just downright evil, King said. But they might have 20% of good. King said he chooses to see the 20% and work with that 20%. Because then we can identify with the humanity of everybody. So together, let's embrace that legacy of Nimrod and of Vashti. And with you, Rabbi.
Thank you, Sister Sharon, and thank you, Brother Steve. Back in November, I called the mayor's office to invite the mayor to come today, which I always do. Normally, I usually get a call back from the chief of staff. This year, I didn't. So I got to tell you a funny story. Thursday, I called the mayor's office and asked for the appointment secretary. And the appointment secretary got on. I said, "Hi, this is Steve Winder from Temple Beth Emunah. I just confirmed that the mayor is coming on Sunday morning." So he looks at his paperwork and gets back to him and says, "I'm sorry, the mayor won't be able to make it. He'll be at Messiah Baptist Church." So for 21 years, the mayors of our city have accepted the responsibility to join us. It is now my honor to welcome once again Mayor Bill Carpenter.
I was a little worried where he was going with that story. First of all, my thanks to both the temple and to the church for again hosting this wonderful program that's found its new home here at Messiah. It's great, Pastor Walker, to be back with you and my Messiah family. Each year I have attended and had the privilege to speak, and I'm always very careful to bring a different Dr. King quote on Sunday than I used on Saturday, knowing that some people may have been at both events. However, I'm going to deviate from that this year. I am going to recycle yesterday's, because as I looked at the program and I saw the keynote speaker, Chief DiGiannatorio, help me, Chief.
Dijon
Vittorio. Jim. I was going to go with Chief Jim all along. I should have stayed with it. But thinking about the keynote speaker and the topic, and I thought that I couldn't do any better than the words of Dr. King that I shared yesterday, so I'll share them again. People fail to get along because they don't know each other. They fear each other because they don't know each other. They don't know each other because they have not communicated with each other. And when I think about the state of our country and the state of our city today, thinking about the fear and the different types of fear that we're faced with today, you know, we do have communities and people within communities in our city and our country that fear the police. We also need to understand that we have families of police officers who fear their loved one may not come home from work today. And we have, particularly in a city like Brockton, we have immigrant communities in this city who fear what the future might bring with the new administration. So there's a lot of fear going around right now. And I think that Dr. King points us in the right direction with communication. And I believe that just because we may be a country divided right now does not mean we have to be a city divided. And I think that Brockton, being such a diverse community, I think that we are really positioned to be a leader and show the rest of the country what a 21st century in America should look like and conduct itself. And I hope that we can work together towards that goal.
Amen.
Thank you, Steve. So a couple of things I would like to mention that will tie in with our theme and with our keynote speaker. A year ago at the NAACP breakfast, I announced the reinstatement of the Diversity Commission. Today, I would like to announce the reinstatement of the Citizens Police Academy, which has been dormant for about 10 years now, maybe even a little longer than 10 years. And I think that as part of our growing commitment and expansion of community policing, this is another aspect of community policing, that this academy will run for residents who are interested to participate in one night a week for 6 or 8 weeks, but designed to give the community a clearer understanding of police work and a clearer understanding of the challenges and the issues that are faced by the police department. But it's also to continue that communication, bridge that gap, so that both the police can have a better understanding of what the community is thinking and the community can have greater insight to the police. And where these types of Citizens Police Academies have been offered, what we find is that after participating in a Citizens Police Academy, the general feedback is that people tend to have greater respect and less fear of the police department and their community for having participated. So in February, we intend to run these academies 2 or 3 times a year. The first one will be in February, and normally these will be available to any resident who would like to sign up, first come, first serve. But we thought with this first one, it would be important to invite an array of folks from across the community to make sure that everyone has a seat in that first academy. So I would, Pastor, like to offer to Messiah you or your designee a seat in that academy, and pastors to all the churches, if you would like to have someone from your congregation, from your leadership, or yourself attend the academy, we will save a seat for you because we believe it's that important. We need the clergy as we go forward in this city and work together. We need the clergy. The other announcement related to this I'd like to make, and again invite Pastor Walker and Messiah and the other churches in the city to help us, is we have formed a partnership and an understanding with the Brockton Police Department, the Mayor's Office, the Mass Association of Minority Law Enforcement Officers, the NAACP, to work together in community outreach to promote and inform about the availability of the upcoming civil service exam for police officer, which is coming up in March. The deadline to register is in February. And we believe, when you look at the Brockton Police Department, we talk about diversity. If I had to give us a grade, I guess the grade would be incomplete. We've made some great progress in our patrol force, in our detective bureau. About 35% of our patrol force are minority officers today. About 25% of our detectives are minority officers today. Unfortunately, when we get to the supervising ranks, that diversity has not yet been reflected. And 34 out of the 36 supervising officers are white men, which means only 2.5%. One female Latino sergeant that we have as a minority, and I was proud to appoint her. So we've still got some work to do. And as we look at this challenge and we come at it from a number of different directions, I think that we agree that it's important that a piece of this puzzle is that we have to expand and encourage more members of all the communities of the city to consider a career in law enforcement and to get more highly qualified applicants to take the exam so that we can have this more diverse pool of people to hire from. And we're getting it done now in terms of the patrol ranks, but if we're going to advance people up the ladder, we've got to keep getting good people in on the front end. And so we think it's important that we all work together over the next 6 or 7 weeks to spread the word amongst all of the communities of the city of the opportunity coming up to take the police officer exam. And then subsequent to when we pass the deadline, MAMLEO, the Mass Association of Minority Law Enforcement Officers, has made a commitment to come down and run a one-day prep class or camp to help people prepare for the test, for people, particularly for folks who have never taken it before, to give them some preparation and a better chance of getting a good score. So I think that those are very concrete steps we can continue to make, but they'll only work if we can all embrace these goals and work on them together, and that's what I'm here asking you to join me in doing today. And finally, I'll conclude my remarks with a policy statement on behalf of the city of Brockton. I think that because of all the fear and uncertainty that I referenced earlier, and I'm going to get my glasses out for this to make sure I get it right. In recognition of the life and work of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and acknowledging the divisiveness and uncertainty regarding race, culture, and equality in our country today, as mayor and a member of the U.S. Coalition of Cities Against Racism and Discrimination, I offer the following statement of policy for the city of Brockton. We believe in and stand for values of inclusion, equity, and justice. We welcome all people and recognize the rights of individuals to live their lives with dignity, free of discrimination because of their faith, race, national origin, immigration status, or sexual orientation. We will continue our work in making our services and programs accessible and open to all individuals. And we believe in the public sector for the public good. Advancing equity and inclusion is critical to the success of our city and our nation. And we'll be, I actually announced that yesterday, but it'll be posted on the city's website on Tuesday. And as long as our administration is there, those are words that we will live by. And I think that it's important in times like these to put it in writing and be held accountable. And that's what I'm hoping that we're doing today with that statement, is putting it in writing and being held accountable. Thank you. So my final words from Dr. King I'll leave you with. We must learn to live together as brothers or perish together as fools. Let's live together as brothers. Thank you.
When I asked Eastern Bank to sponsor this event, they stood up and continued to do so, along with all their other charitable work in the community. Sean Boucher, Vice President of Eastern Bank, was scheduled to be here today. A family issue came up at the last minute, and he asked me to read his remarks, which I'll do right now. This is from Sean Boucher, Vice President of Eastern Bank. Good afternoon. Thank you for allowing me to share this celebration honoring Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., an individual who sought out equality and fairness for all people. Years after his passing, his spirit lives on through others who continue pursuing his goals. From our very beginning, Eastern Bank's mission has been to provide much needed help to our communities. We were founded in Salem, Massachusetts in 1818, to serve people of modest means who did not have access to the banking system. We are now based in Boston, now the largest and oldest mutual bank in the country, with just under $10 billion in assets and more than 100 branches serving communities in eastern Massachusetts and southern coastal New Hampshire. Eastern Bank offers banking, investment, and insurance all under one roof. We work hard to understand our customers' needs so we can deliver these services in a committed and personal way. At Eastern Bank, we practice the basic principles of corporate social responsibility for almost 200 years. We pride ourselves on being true to our employees by offering tremendous opportunities for individual growth. As an inclusive company, we work to ensure that our valued employees are treated fairly, recognized for their individuality, and encouraged to reach their fullest potential. We're very proud to be recognized as the Boston Globe top places to work for 7 consecutive years. We also placed the top 100 in the national survey by Workplace Dynamics of top workplaces in the United States. We're weekly honored to be recognized by the Human Rights Campaign as one of the best places to work in an inclusive environment. Over the past almost 20 years, our mission has expanded to charitable giving, social justice, and protecting the environment. Those efforts are more and more a part of our community strategy, which rests on 4 pillars: the Eastern Bank's Charitable Foundation, volunteerism, leadership, and advocacy. Since 1999, we have contributed 10% of our annual net income, nearly 7 times the national corporate median, to charitable endeavors, totaling more than $60 million in the past decade. In 2016, Eastern Bank's Charitable Foundation has donated more than $6 million to 1,500 not-for-profits across eastern Massachusetts and southern New Hampshire. Our support goes beyond dollars. At last count, Eastern Bank employees donated more than 40,000 hours to organizations as volunteers. They can be found swinging hammers at Habitat for Humanity building sites, painting walls with the local Boys and Girls Club, or discussing strategic planning ideas as a board member for any of a number of organizations. May this day be filled with the celebration of MLK's good work and the hope that his memory will continue to be shared with future generations. And that's from Sean Boucher, Vice President of Eastern Bank. Temple Beth Emunah Brotherhood is part of the regional and international federation. Speaking on behalf of New England Federation Jewish Men's Club is Executive Vice President Elliot Feldman.
Thank you, Steve. It's a pleasure being here today to speak on, you know, such a significant occasion in terms of marking Dr. King. Not such a pleasure following such great speakers. great clergy, great the mayor, Sharon, wonderful. Now you're stuck with me in my prepared remarks, sorry. And also, I have to, a true confession is that Rabbi Gauss is a personal friend of ours. In fact, she and her family were at our Friday night dinner. And she, Rabbi Gauss, officiated my wife's and my wedding. So you think, like, and we talked about the program, right? So you think, like, well, you know, maybe I should say, Rabbi, what quote are you going to be doing at Rabbi? But obviously, I didn't have enough brains to do that. So, and it's really funny, too, because obviously what I'm struck by this is how many fantastic quotes Rabbi Dr. King had. I mean, very significant. And so she and I landed on the same one. That's later on. Later on. Right now. So it is my honor today to represent the New England region, the Federation of Jewish Men's Clubs. And let me explain what that means in English, that as Steve has already alluded, there's men's clubs throughout New England. And so we have a region. And so the president of the region is right over there, David Singer. And I'm the executive vice president. And so we've been participating in this program for quite some time. It's our privilege to participate in this program for quite some time. So I come here today to honor the memory of Dr. Martin Luther King and to honor the civil rights movement, which he led. Men's clubs are often referred to as brotherhoods. I see a brotherhood between African and Jewish Americans. Why did that happen? I think because of common struggles. American Jews well remember the historical persecution that faced people who faced in our country's history. The Ku Klux Klan targeted both blacks and Jews. Jews faced discrimination from the moment they came to America. Father Charles Edward Coughlin, anybody know that name? Was famous for his radio broadcast blaming American Jews for all of Americans' problems. This was national radio. His rantings helped persuade Americans not to allow Jewish refugees into the United States when they were trying to flee Nazi terror. Is anybody here, and just raise your hand, all right, ever heard of the 1939 voyage of the ship to St. Louis? Some people have. Great. Unfortunately, it's a piece of important tragic Jewish history. The St. Louis sailed from Germany with 937 Jewish refugees. It was headed to America, but was scheduled to stop in Havana, Cuba, so the passengers could get their entry visas for the United States. Ultimately, the anti-Semitic furor that was caused in part by Father Coughlin and others prevented the St. Louis from getting permission to come to Cuba because the passengers would never be granted visas to come to America. The ship was forced to return back to Germany, where the vast majority of Jews were slaughtered in Nazi death camps. I tell you this to give you a little backdrop of why so many Jews are involved in the civil rights movement. And one in particular I'd like to talk a little bit about is Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel. Familiar with Heschel? Good. Big smile from the Reverend. Rabbi Heschel was born in Warsaw, Poland. He was ordained as a rabbi in Europe and was unable to finish his doctorate in Germany because of the anti-Semitism. After Adolf Hitler came to power and began his campaign against Jews, many rabbinic seminaries in America invited European rabbis to teach at their schools. That's how Rabbi Heschel ended up in America. He's considered to be one of the great theologians in the 20th century. However, it was his experience during the Holocaust and a study of Jewish prophets that influenced his belief that Judaism required a life filled with both deeds and actions. Known as Father Abraham in the Civil Rights Movement, he was to many and many of Dr. King's followers, Rabbi Heschel was an outspoken activist for civil rights who marched with Dr. King, met with John F. Kennedy about civil rights legislation, and is celebrated by many in the Jewish community for his involvement in the civil rights movement and other movements for social justice. His reflection on participating on the civil rights movement, this Rabbi Gauss didn't I talk about this. Thank you for letting me have this one. Anytime, you're so gracious. In the civil rights movement from Selma, from the march from Selma to Montgomery, Alabama in March 1965, I felt like my legs were praying. has become a model of activism in religious practice. He literally walked arm in arm with Dr. King in that march. I have a telegram. I'm going to try and hard to read it. This was a telegram that Rabbi Heschel sent to President Kennedy. So bear with me, it's not that clear. But I look forward to our meeting that's tomorrow. At the meeting tomorrow, the likelihood exists that the Negro problem will be like the weather. Everybody talks about it, but nobody does anything about it. Please demand of religious leaders personal involvement, not just solemn declaration. We forfeit the right to worship God, forfeit the right to worship God as long as we continue to humiliate Negroes. Church synagogues have failed. They must represent and advocate for personal sacrifice. Let religious leaders donate 1 month of their salary to fund Negro housing and social services. This is a moral emergency. A Marshall Plan has to be put in place to aid Negroes from this day forward. That was Rabbi Heschel's telegram to President Kennedy. I believe that the spirit of Dr. Martin Luther King and Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel really actually lives on today. Both great men would teach us that as long as the powerless are oppressed, we all are oppressed. The rights of people of color, immigrants, Muslims, and the poor are being challenged as much now as they were in the 1960s, unfortunately. These are difficult times for all of us. It might surprise some of us here to learn that the FBI reported that in 2015, Jews were the most targeted religious group that year, and that they were victims of 11% of all hate crimes. The same report also suggested that blacks and Jews remain disproportionate targets of hate crimes as opposed to whites. And this is the Boston Globe, January 7, 2017. We're talking last week's Globe. I don't have specific statistics, but I do know that the number of crimes that have exploded this year as new political forces are now happening. It's a time for all of us to remember the example set by Dr. King and Rabbi Heschel. We need to fight injustice whenever and wherever we see it. Let us honor Dr. King by remembering his quote from the Birmingham jail of 1963. It's a great quote. I'll use it. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Thank you.
Member Temple Beth Emunah became the first president of the NAACP in Brockton. Yesterday, William Brewer was installed as president, and he makes one of his first public appearances today as president of the NAACP. It's my honor to welcome to our stage Mr. William Brewer.
Good afternoon.
It is a pleasure to be here with you, Reverend Walker, Rabbi Gauss. Point of privilege, I just want to thank the mayor, who I see today, and our elected officials. I want to acknowledge the members of the temple, as well as the congregation of Messiah Baptist Church. So thank you. It's my pleasure to be here with you to celebrate the 21st annual luncheon honoring the memory of Dr. Martin Luther King. One of the things that Steve has sent out to me was that he would like for me to talk about racial profiling. And so I'm here to discuss racial profiling. It is a problem, it continues to be a problem, and the only way to fix the problem is to talk about the problem. Racial profiling is a practice by law enforcement officials to target individuals for suspicions of a crime based on their individual race, ethnicity, religion, national origin, racial profiling is a long-standing and deeply troubling problem for America. It occurs every day in our cities, in our towns, across the country. Law enforcement targeting people of color, often frightening, detaining, interrogating, searches without evidence of criminal activities based solely on the perception of race, ethnicity, national origin. Racial profiling is patently illegal. It violates the U.S. Constitution, core principle of equal protection under law, and freedom from unreasonable search and seizure. Racial profiling is ineffective. It alienates the communities that law enforcement hinders their community policing efforts. Efforts caused by law enforcement to lose their credibility with the people that they serve. People are sworn to protect and serve cannot racial profile. The fact of the matter is, as a young man growing up, we saw the police as someone to view us. They watched us. Other communities saw them as being their protectors. Racial profile has led to people to live in fear, to castigate entire communities, simply because of where they lived and where they are. We look forward to dealing with our racial profile in the city of Brockton. I had an opportunity to read a court decision not too long ago, and it said that black men had a legitimate fear from the police, and it was okay to run. That wasn't in Alabama. That wasn't in Mississippi. That was Massachusetts. That was Boston. Here in Massachusetts, citing disproportionate stops of black males by Boston police, Massachusetts Supreme Court declared that black males have a legitimate reason to flee from police officers. They have a legitimate reason to flee. Imagine that. In part, the ruling stated that such individuals, when approached by police, might just as easily be motivated by the desire to avoid reoccurring indignities of being racial profiled as a desire to hide criminal activity. The Massachusetts Supreme Court stated that rather than finding that black males in Boston are disproportionately repeatedly targeted, suggests a reason for flight, unrelated to any conscious of guilt. We must end the practice of racial profiling. It affects our communities, it affects our teens, it affects the adults. Racial profiling. When you lose the moral authority with racial profiling, your legal authority is diminished. As been said this morning, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Racial profiling is an injustice. I thank you.
Time for an encore from the Massachusetts Messiah Baptist Jazz Quartet. Jazz. Feelings of what Dr. King stood for. I am honored to ask Felicia Freilich from Messiah Baptist to read the poem. She will immediately be followed by Keith Jackson of Messiah, reciting a speech written by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
Standing Tall by Jamie McKenzie, in honor of Martin Luther King. Some kings rule their kingdoms sitting down, surrounded by luxury, soft cushions, and fans, but this king stood strong, stood proud, stood tall. When the driver told Rosa, move to the back of the bus.
All right now.
When the waiter told students, we don't serve your kind. When the mayor told voters, your vote don't count.
Teach the story.
And when the sheriff told marchers, get off our streets. Using fire hoses, police dogs, and cattle prods to move them along. This king stood strong, stood proud, stood tall, speaking of peace, of love, and children, hand in hand, free at last, free at last. When some yelled for violence, for angry revenge, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth, he stood his ground, preaching peace. And when some spit out hate, he stood there smiling, spreading love, until it rolled like the sea across the land, sweeping away Jim Crow, breaking down the walls, ringing the bell joyfully for freedom. Until, standing on the mountaintop, they shot him, coldly, hoping to see him fall, hoping to put him away, to bring him low. But this king, even in death, even today, stands strong, stands proud, stands tall, and we remember.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I'm a little more comfortable over here than I am up there. I'm not going to be reciting, actually, this afternoon. I'm going to be doing Paul's letter to American Christians that Martin delivered at Dexter Avenue Baptist Church back in 1956. So that's 60 years ago, 61 years ago almost, so 60 years ago. And the reason I'm not reciting this is because I don't know it. I haven't learned it yet. So at some point I was sharing with Sharon earlier today how thankful I was that she had asked me to come and do a Dr. King speech, because for 30 years I've been doing the same three or four speeches and I just had no inspiration anymore. The fire was dwindling on doing it. And when she asked me to do something today, I don't even know why I said yeah, but I said, sure, Sharon, I will. And then she told me, and I have to thank my pastor as well, because he was the one that suggested one of two different speeches, World House, which is another marvelous speech, or this Paul's letter to American Christians. And I didn't know either one, really. But now, having heard this one for the first time today, I'm going to learn it.
Right.
And I was sharing, I don't remember who I said it to, but I said, hopefully within the year, by God's grace, I'll be asked to come and do a speech of Dr. King's. And this is the one, because this thing is marvelous.
Next year.
So bear with me. I'm going to be reading it this time, but by God's grace, I assure you, within the year, if you want to come here. And also, this is also, I'm cutting it short. I was asked to cut it a little short only because of time. So, Martin, I don't know of any, I think I may have been able to get through his desired eulogy in 10 or 15 minutes. That's about it. Nothing else that he wrote or spoke about or talked about, to my knowledge, can be done in 10 or 15 minutes. So bear with me. And I encourage all of you, this recording is online.
Yeah.
So if you have a computer and you've got a speaker, I encourage you, go and write and type into Google Martin Luther King's Paul's letter to American Christians and listen to the vocal. Because even this writing, when I was listening to it, following along, which is one of my learning techniques, he's talking and I'm, wait, that's not there. And then he'd come back to where I am and I'm like, wow, that was 5 minutes and we need to know that. So I encourage you, go and listen to this sermon that was delivered, this imaginary letter. And I'll do my best to sound as much like him, because I know that, you know, we all like the way Martin, something about the way he sounded. It makes me feel good even when I hear him now. So I would like to share with you an imaginary letter from the pen of the Apostle Paul. The postmark reveals that it comes from the city of Ephesus. And after opening the letter, I discovered that it was written in Greek rather than in English. And at the top of the first page was this request. Please read to your congregation as soon as possible, and then pass on to the other churches. Well, I've labored for several days with the translation, and at times it's been very, very difficult. But now I think I have deciphered its true meaning. May I hasten to say that if in presenting this letter, the content sounds strangely Kingian instead of Paulinian. Attribute that to my lack of objectivity rather than Paul's lack of clarity. It is miraculous indeed that the Apostle Paul should be writing a letter to you and I nearly 1900 years after his last letter appeared in the New Testament. How this is possible, I don't know and don't really care. The important thing is that I can imagine the Apostle Paul writing a letter to American Christians in 1956 AD. And here is that letter as it stands before me. I, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to you who are in America, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For many years I've longed to be able to come to see you. I've heard so much of you and of what you are doing. I have heard of the fascinating and astounding advances that you have made in the scientific realm. I have heard of your dashing subways and your flashing airplanes. And through your scientific genius, you have been able to dwarf distance and place time in change. You have been able to carve highways through the stratosphere. So in your world, you have made it possible to eat breakfast in New York City and dinner in Paris, France. I've also heard of your
skyscraping buildings with their prodigious towers steeping towards heaven. I've heard of your great medical advances, which have resulted in the curing of many dreaded diseases and plagues, thereby prolonged your lives and made for greater security and physical well-being. And all of that is wonderful. You can do so many things in your day that I could not do in the Greco-Roman world of my day. And in your age, you can travel distances in one day that took me 3 months to travel. And that's a wonderful thing. You have made tremendous strides in the area of scientific and technological development. Oh, but America, as I look at you from afar, I wonder whether your moral and spiritual progress has been commensurate with your scientific progress. It seems to me that your moral progress lags behind your scientific progress. Your poet Thoreau used to talk about improved means to an unimproved end. How often this is true? You have allowed the material means by which you live to outdistance the spiritual ends for which you live. You have allowed your mentality to outrun your morality. You have allowed your civilization to outdistance your culture. And through your scientific genius, you have made of the world a neighborhood, but through your moral and spiritual genius, you have failed to make it a brotherhood. So, America, I would urge you to keep your moral advances abreast with your scientific advances. I am impelled to write you concerning the responsibilities laid upon you to live as Christians in the midst of an unchristian world. That is what I had to do. That is what every Christian has to do. But I understand that there are many Christians in America who give their ultimate allegiance to man-made systems and customs. They are afraid to be different. Their great concern is to be accepted socially. They live by some such principles as this: everybody is doing it, so it must be all right. For so many of you, morality is merely group consensus. In your modern sociological lingo, the mores are accepted as the right way. You have unconsciously come to believe that right is discovered by taking a sort of Gallup poll of the majority opinion. How many are giving their ultimate allegiances to this way? But American Christians, I must say to you, as I said to the Roman Christians years ago, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Or as I said to the Philippian Christians, ye are a colony of heaven. This means that although you live in the colony of time, your ultimate allegiance is to the empire of eternity. You have a dual citizenry. You live both in time and eternity, both in heaven and earth. Therefore, your ultimate allegiance is not to the government, not to the state, not to the nation, not to any made man institution. The Christian owes his ultimate allegiance to God, God alone. If any earthly institution conflicts with God's will, it is your Christian duty is your Christian duty. It is your Christian duty to take a stand against it. You must never allow the transitory, ever since, demands of man-made institutions to take precedence over the eternal demands of the Almighty God. Let me rush on to say something about the church. Americans, I must remind you, as I have said to so many others, that the church is the body of Christ. So when the church is true in its nature, it knows neither division nor disunity. But I am disturbed about what you are doing to the body of Christ. They tell me that in America you have within Protestantism more than 256 denominations. The tragedy is not so much that you have such a multiplicity of denominations, but that most of them are warring against each other with a claim to absolute. This narrow sectarianism is destroying the unity of the body of Christ. You must come to see that God is neither a Baptist nor a Methodist. He is neither a Presbyterian nor Episcopalian. God is bigger than all of our denominations. If you are to be true witnesses for Christ, you must come to see that, America. It's all man-made. But I must not stop with criticism of Protestantism. I am disturbed about Roman Catholicism. This church stands before the world with its pomp and power, insisting that it possesses the only truth. It incorporates an arrogance that becomes a dangerous spiritual arrogance. It stands with its noble Pope, who somehow rises to the miraculous heights of infallibility when he speaks ex cathedra. But I am disturbed about a person or an institution that claims infallibility in this world. I am disturbed about any church that refuses to cooperate with other churches under the pretense that it is the only true church. I must emphasize the fact that God is not a Roman Catholic, and that the boundless sweep of his revelation cannot be limited to the Vatican. Roman Catholicism must do a great deal to mend its ways. There is another thing that disturbs me to no end about the American church. You have a white church, and you have a Negro church. You have allowed segregation to creep into the doors of the church. How can such a division exist in the true body of Christ? You must face the tragic fact, that when you stand at 11 on Sunday morning to sing "All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name" and "Dear Lord and Father of All Mankind," you stand in the most segregated hour of Christian America. They tell me there is more integration in the entertaining world and other secular agencies than there is in the Christian church. How appalling is that? I understand there are Christians among you who try to justify segregation on the basis of the Bible. They argue that the Negro is inferior by nature because of Noah's curse upon the children of Ham. Oh, my friends, this is blasphemy. This is against everything that the Christian religion stands for. I must say to you, as I have said to so many Christians before, that in Christ there is neither Jew nor Gentile. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For we are all one in Christ Jesus. Moreover, I must reiterate the words that I uttered on Mars Hill. God that made the world and all things therein hath made one blood all nation of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth. And so, Americans, I must urge you to get rid of every aspect of segregation. The broad universalism standing at the center of the gospel makes both the theory and practice of segregation morally unjustifiable. Segregation is a blatant denial of the unity which we all have in Christ. It substitutes an I-it relationship for the I-thou relationship. The segregator relegates the segregated to the status of a thing rather than elevate him to the status of a person. The underlying philosophy of Christianity is diametrically opposed to the underlying philosophy of segregation. And all the dialects of the logicians cannot make them lie down together. Many persons will realize the urgency of seeking to eradicate the evils of segregation. There will be many Negroes who will devote their lives to the cause of freedom. There will be many white persons of goodwill and strong morality, of moral sensitivity, who will dare to stand and take a stand for justice. Honesty impels me to admit that such a stand will require willingness to suffer and sacrifice. So don't despair if you are condemned and persecuted for righteousness' sake. Whenever you take a stand for truth and justice, you are liable to scorn. Often you will be called an impractical idealist or a dangerous radical. Sometimes it might mean going to jail. If such is the case, you must honorably grace the jail with your presence. It might even mean physical death. But if physical death is the price that some must pay to free their children from a permanent life of psychological death, then nothing could be more Christian. Don't worry about persecutions, America. You're going to have that if you stand up for a great principle. I could say this with some authority because my life was a continual round of persecutions. After my conversion, I was rejected by the disciples at Jerusalem. Later, I was tried for a round of persecution. And my conversion, I was rejected by the disciples at Jerusalem. Later, I was tried for heresy at Jerusalem. I was jailed at Philippi, beaten at Thessalonica, mobbed at Ephesus, and depressed at Athens. And yet, I am still going. I came away from each of these experiences more persuaded than ever before that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things past. I came away from each of these experiences more persuaded than ever before that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present nor things to come, shall separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I still believe that standing up for the truth of God is the greatest thing in the world. This is the end of life. The end of life is not to be happy. The end of life is not to achieve pleasure and avoid pain. The end of life is to do the will of God, come what may. I must bring my writing to a close now. Timothy is waiting to deliver this letter, and I must take leave for another church. But just before leaving, I must say to you, as I said to the church at Corinth, that I still believe that love is the most durable power in the world. While you didn't hear it, I must say to you, as I said to the church in Corinth, that I still believe that love is the most durable power in the world. Over the centuries, men have started to discover the highest good, been the chief question of ethical philosophy. Yeah. This was the big question of Greek philosophy. The Epicurean and the Stoics sought to answer it. Plato and Aristotle sought to answer it. What is the sum and bonum of life? I think I have the answer, America. I think I have discovered the highest good. It is love. It is love. The principle stands at the center of the cosmos. As John says, God is love. He who loves is a participant in the being of God. He who hates does not know God. So, American Christians, you may master the intricacies of the English language. You may possess all of the eloquencies of audible speech, of articulate speech. But even if you speak with the tongues of man and angels and have not love, you are become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. You may have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries. You may be able to break into the storehouse of nature and bring out many insights that men never dreamed were there. You may ascend to the heights of academic achievement so that you will have all knowledge. You may boast of your great institutions of learning and the boundless extent of your degrees, but all of this amounts to absolutely nothing devoid of love. But even more, Americans, you may give your goods to feed the poor. You may give great gifts to charity. You may tower high in philanthropy, but if you have not love, it means nothing. You may even give your body to be burned and die the death of a martyr. Your split blood may be a symbol of honor for generations yet unborn, and thousands may praise you as history's supreme hero. But even so, if you have not love, your blood was spilt in vain. You must come to see that it is possible for a man to be self-centered in his self-denial and self-righteous in his self-sacrifice. He may be generous in order to feed his ego and pious in order to feed his pride. Man has the tragic capacity to relegate a heightening virtue to a tragic vice. Without love, benevolence becomes egotism. And martyrdom becomes spiritual pride. So the greatest of all virtues is love. It is here that we find the true meaning of Christian faith. That is at the bottom of the meaning of the cross. The great event on Calvary signifies more than a meaningless drama that took place on the stage of history. It is a telescope through which we look out into the long vista of eternity and see the love of God breaking forth into time. It is an eternal reminder to a power-drunk generation that love is most durable, it is the most durable power in the world, and that it is at the bottom, the heartbeat of the moral cosmos. Only through achieving this love can you expect to matriculate into the university of eternal life. I must say goodbye now. I hope this letter will find you strong in the faith. It is probable that I will not get to see you in America, but I will meet you in God's eternity. And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to lift us from the fatigue of despair to the buoyancy of hope, from the midnight of desperation to the daybreak of joy, to him be power, authority, forever.
Like I said earlier today, this is our 21st year in And today is our 20th speaker because we had the Tuskegee twice. I just noticed that a former speaker came back today, so I'd like to recognize Shayna. I'd just like to recognize you as a former speaker of our, keynote speaker of our program. Shayna Barnes. So why are we here today, and why do we have law enforcement as our keynote speaker? Dr. King once said, if I cannot do great things, I can do small things a great way. Our guest speaker's career has been one of doing small things in a great way. His tenure in Milton has been one of working in the community and reaching all people. In an age where law enforcement has been singled out, both for some bad apples, but also for the target of violence, Dr. King would not stand for the violence, but would totally support events like today. I am honored to introduce our keynote speaker, Chief James Deegee, the new president of the Massachusetts Chiefs of Police Association. Jim.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Thank you for having me. There is no way I can match what I just heard. Steve, we're going to talk. When I got up earlier, I thought that was when that was my time. I would have loved that to be of my time. Mr. Mayor, thank you. Reverend, Rabbi. I do have a speech I want to talk about, but before I do, I want you to know a little bit about me before I talk. I've been a police officer for 32 years. I started my career in Danvers, which is on the North Shore, and then I went to the town of Middleton. I live in West Peabody. I've lived in West Peabody for about 53 years of my life. I'm 55 years old. For those who know the service, 55 and 32 are the magic numbers. Those numbers are a milestone in a police officer's career. That's when we can leave. I'm not leaving yet. I love my job. Mr. Brewer, congratulations. I thought I was going to be the one who says, this is my first speech as president. I've been president for 15 days now. A little bit about myself. Not only am I the chief of Middleton Police Department and the president of the Massachusetts Police Chiefs Association, I'm also, and I have been for the past 10 years, the executive director of the Law Enforcement Torch Run for Special Olympics. Special Olympics is near and dear to my heart. It's a group of individuals with intellectual disabilities who've been discriminated against all their lives. So I know where they're coming from. I've been dealing with them for many, many years. 4 years ago, I was honored to be chosen 100 officers out of the world, not just the country, to participate in the World Games in Greece. My town allowed me to go to Greece. And I know most of you are looking at me and saying he's a marathon runner, okay? Well, there's many things you can do when you have the will and you put your mind to it. I took about 8 months of training, and I ran from the Acropolis, at the top of the Acropolis in Greece, 163 miles with 100 police officers to spread the word of awareness for people with intellectual disabilities prior to the World Games in Greece in 2011. I'm a proud grandfather of 4 grandkids. I have 3 kids of my own. You have a very unique situation here. When Steve called me, he said, would you like to be a keynote speaker? I said, sure, what am I coming to? Well, he said, you're gonna come to the Baptist church, okay, for the temple. I said, okay. So I've been very proud since Steve called me, and I've been telling everybody that I'm going to be coming here to talk today. But you know who's married here, who has a significant other. They're your biggest critics. Well, when I told my wife I'm coming here today to speak, and she wears glasses, and when she looks over her glasses at me and says, really? I know I'm in trouble. So I really didn't know what I was going to talk about. Since I've been chief in Middleton, I've had a very, very good career. I can honestly say, 32 years, my department, we've never had a lawsuit against us. And that, a lot of police departments can't say that. It comes from the top, training, education. We believe in that in my department. Everybody who spoke today took a little bit of my speech, which you might hear a few things that you've heard before today, which is no problem. Everything I'm going to say in my speech, I hope, wraps up what everybody said earlier. So when I decided to start to write my speech, I didn't know what I was going to write about. I really didn't know much about Martin Luther King other than what I learned in high school, like, you know, in grade school and high school. So I did some research, and I never knew that he had so many profound speeches and phrases. So I tried to pick out ones that would have meaning for what I was going to say today, and you might hear a couple of them that you've heard already today. But that being said, I am going to read from my speech only because I believe that the words and the message is that important. I don't want to miss anything. Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here this afternoon to celebrate the life and work of Dr. Martin Luther King. I want to begin by taking a moment to thank Steve Weiner and the Temple Beth Emunah Brotherhood and the Messiah Baptist Church here in Brockton for inviting me to be part of the 21st annual luncheon held each year to honor Dr. King. As the newly inaugurated president of Mass Chiefs, I'm honored to be here to represent the dedicated police departments who serve the Commonwealth. Today, we rightfully remember Dr. King and how he gave a voice to the silent hopes of millions of Americans. Over five decades have passed since Dr. King's voice cut through the silence, but his words still ring true, possessing a power and an influence unmatched in our times. Dr. King inspired a generation to transform our nation to make a place where generally all men are created equal, a place where all of our children can grow and play and achieve together, and a place where the content of a person's character outweighs the color of their skin. Inspired by both his faith in God and his unshakable belief in righteousness of his cause, Dr. King helped lead a movement that worked to overcome centuries of oppression and discrimination. His teaching showed that violence, segregation, and indecency had already afflicted our nation far too long, and that only the way to heal the wounds of the past and bound onward into the future was by loving and respecting one another. In the words of Dr. Martin Luther King, and you've heard this before, for darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. 49 years have passed since we lost Dr. King, but his message and vision are still relevant today. It's a critical time in our country where tensions are escalating between citizens and law enforcement. We live in a world that unfortunately is imperfect. Aggressions and violence have been used far too often and too freely. Let us not forget the core message of Dr. King or the sacrifice that he made for all. We must be vigilant, courageous, during this time of uncertainty. As a leader in law enforcement, I believe we must take a principled stand in the face of bias, racism, injustice. We must practice mutual respect with the general public, promoting the culture of law enforcement as guardians, not warriors. And as I said before, I am the director of the Law Enforcement Torch Run for Special Olympics. We have the torch, which is our symbol, which we are the guardians of the flame. We lit that torch at the top of the Acropolis by the sun, ran with that torch for 3 weeks. The flame never went out. At night, we put it in a miner's lamp, and in the day, we lit the torch with it. So let us remember that we need to be the guardians and not warriors here. The men and women who commit themselves to the profession of law enforcement take pride in their role. Every day they put their lives on the line to ensure the safety of others. And for that, they do deserve the respect and appreciation. I stand before you today, not as the police chief, not as the president of Mass Chiefs, but a man who took an oath. I took an oath to protect and serve everybody, race, creed, color, no choices. I took an oath to protect everyone. As police chief, I believe that it's my duty to establish and encourage good community relations between my department and the people in my town. It's the duty of all law enforcement officers to build bridges among our communities and not walls. The answer to our nation's current problems will not come from assigning blame to all law enforcement. It'll not come from deepening the divide between our citizens and those that are working to protect them. We must remember the words of Dr. King that returning violence for violence multiplies violence, adding deeper darkness to the night that is already devoid of stars. I have an unwavering faith that the law enforcement community can be instrumental in assisting our communities through this transitional period. The International Chiefs of Police Association immediate past president and Wellesley Police Chief Terrence Cunningham recently spoke about the concepts of the historical injustices and how acknowledging it will allow us to move forward and bridge the current gap of mistrust between law enforcement and the communities of color. For when we acknowledge how we got here and what brought us to this point, only then can we establish a deeper sense of trust. A trust that will foster and enhance relationships with mutual empathy and respect. I also believe that we must be proactive and motivate our police departments to develop new ways of deploying services. Recommitting to the concepts of community policing, for example. I know in my town, I started the first Citizens Police Academy in 1989 and have ran them since. And it's always been one of the highlights of the residents. And anywhere I go, I have hundreds of alumni that we utilize for everything within the town. So it's a great opportunity to connect with the residents. Our police departments must understand the benefits of involving our community in the process from the beginning, promoting police community partnerships, cooperative problem solving, and ways that police can address crime and quality of life issues affecting the communities that they serve. I encourage all ranks to engage in some form of service or outreach, both on duty and off duty. I encourage police chiefs around the Commonwealth to promote the practice of transparency and communication between our departments and our residents. The culture of the police departments begin at the top. The chief establishes the tone for everything from the style of uniform to the policies governing the use of force and procedures for dealing with the victims and suspects. I believe in a three-step method that I've used for the past 10 years that I've been chief. The first step is addressing how the force interacts with the public. The second is how the public perceives the police in your community. And the most important of all is how the chief interacts with his department. Working in all directions is essential because one won't work without the other. None of these steps will be a quick fix, however. Improving interactions with the public and exemplifying standards of professionalism and integrity are all crucial to build an effective police force in the 21st century. Well-known football coach Vince Lombardi once said, "The achievements of an organization are the results of the combined efforts of each individual." All of these actions serve to humanize police officers in the eyes of the public and establish positive and repeatable interactions with our communities. Our culture employs the term hero far too loosely. We overuse it for movie stars, politicians, and professional athletes. While such individuals might have a unique singular ability, or while they might on occasion engage in a heroic effort, they're not our true heroes. Our true heroes are the men and women of law enforcement who demonstrate professionalism under the most trying circumstances. Those who, in the face of danger, run towards the threat, not far from away from it. These are our true heroes. I would like to share with you a recent personal experience. And as I mentioned earlier, I've been very fortunate in my career to do many things as a chief that a lot of chiefs don't have the opportunity to do. About 3 weeks ago, I just returned from Israel. I was one of 15 police chiefs from around the Commonwealth to attend a counterterrorism seminar in Israel. 9-day event sponsored by the Anti-Defamation League. I traveled with 15 members of law enforcement from around the Commonwealth, and we had the opportunity to learn counterterrorism strategies and tactics, with a special emphasis on suicide bombings and securing transportation infrastructures. The training was done through presentations and site visits conducted by senior personnel in the Israeli National Police, intelligence and security services, in the Israeli Defense Forces. I returned from this trip with a new perspective. I realized that our nation, despite the struggles, the setbacks, and the issues we face, we still live in a country where its possibility and the opportunity for peace, love, and prosperity are a reality. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness are not distant ideals, but genuine concepts that we abide by. How fortunate are we to live in a country where the message and vision of such men like Dr. King are not only supported on this day, celebrated with due respect of this grateful nation. Locally, I urge everyone not to become complacent. Be more vigilant. See something, say something. During my visit to Israel, as we sat in the ADL office in Tel Aviv, there was a terrorist attack just a few miles from our location. We witnessed firsthand the low-key response from the media. It turned out to be on the seventh page of the news media that day. They don't let terrorism rule their life, as we do in this country, we dwell on it. So as we pause today to remember Dr. King, let us continue to embrace his message, his dream. Together, let us help drive out the darkness and the hate that threatens to hold us back. Let us continue to move forward together with genuine love, peace, and respect for one another. In closing, I'd like to share one more quote from Dr. King, which states, "We must develop and maintain the capacity to forgive. He who is devoid the power to forgive is devoid the power to love. There is some good in the worst of us and some evil in the best of us. When we discover this, we are less prone to hate our enemies." Thank you and God bless.
This donation to the law enforcement torch run for Special Olympics is Noah's dear and close to your heart.
Thank you.
And this is in your name.
Thank you.
Thank you. To close out our program, it's an honor to me to welcome a rabbi from a little distance away. Greg Hirsch from Temple Emunah in Wakefield is going to do our closing prayer. Greg is a new rabbi, actually ordained in 2016.
And it's my honor to be here with you all today to celebrate the life, vision, and achievements of Martin Luther King. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is among the greatest men to have ever walked this earth. Like the Hebrew prophets, like Jesus, King could not sit idly by while injustices were being committed. Like his biblical predecessors, King inspired millions with his words. He spoke truth to power, and he remains a role model for all of us today. King once said that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. He knew that his fight for civil rights and equality was righteous and just. Knowing the truth, validity, and importance of his mission, he was an unstoppable force for peace, loving kindness, and compassion. But as we know, King's mission is not yet fulfilled. I appreciate that all of you have gathered here for the last 21 years to remember King's legacy. Martin Luther King Day is an important time for all of us to think about the progress that's been made in the 20th century toward equality and justice. But it's also a time to recognize that King's mission is not yet complete. As we remember the legacy of this great leader, a modern-day prophet, May we all be inspired by his life and his example. May we remember King's love of humanity and his yearning for justice. May we be inspired by his ability to forgive, to find common ground, and to fight with everything we have for what is right. May we help to bring about more peace and more justice in our time.
So in 21 years, we've been doing basically the same things. And we've walked away each year with homework, and today will not be any exception. We are awake, we are powerful, and we're responsible. Don't take Dr. King's dream for granted. We have work to do. In the Baptist church, we sing a little song that says, "Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say amen." Now, you may not consider yourself a church. You know, we don't all go to synagogue or to temple. But let the folks say amen. Let the folk say amen. God has spoken. Let the church and folks say amen. You've heard Dr. King today in so many forms, in so many ways. God has spoken. We have work to do. We can't just wait for this time to turn around again next year and say, "What's new?" Let's create something new. Let your light shine, not just for you, but for others. For in our doing, we are moving each other forward. And we cannot move forward without each other. Let the church say amen.
Everybody be safe. Thank you very much.